problems. Now, actually, what happened was that the Welsh television company, who were interested about this debate, you know, is there a high level of leukemia? Isn't there a high level of leukemia? Busby says this, they say that, they say he's a nutcase, he says they're crooks. Who's right, okay? So these people, Twelly Griffiths and Linda Perry, they actually went and knocked on doors up in North Wales and they said, have you got childhood leukemia in the house, you see? And they did, they found them, they found the children, they found them, we got their names and addresses and everything. And from and this was an update now, so from we got from 2000 to 2003, we found a 21-fold excess. So never mind about the Sellafield leukemia cluster where it's a 10-fold excess, now we've got a 21-fold excess and an 18-fold excess of brain tumours in this little area where the radiation ends up, okay? So they can't, and they're the children, they're their names. Kemlyn, Chelsea, Ryan, Ruth, Lee Thomas, Reese, Max, Klinos, Gareth, they're all there, and that's where they live, you see? So there's no argument about this now, but of course there was. So the Wells Cancer Registry, was the new one, was sent off to do some sums, and they said, oh, well, we've got the populations wrong. So although there are all these leukemias, we agree that they're leukemias. Actually, there are lots more children than Busby thought there was, you see? So this was another argument. Anyway, we resolved that argument too. So all the arguments are resolved now. They're wrong, I'm right, and they've been shopped up to the authorities, and the British Medical Association is investigating. Well, we'll, you know, don't hold your breath. Anyway, that's what's happening. And they haven't taken me to court, and I've put everywhere around in the media, said that they're a bunch of crooks, and this guy's a crook, and this is his name, and go and throw things at him, and so on. And no, he hasn't sued me. Because he knows I'm right, and he doesn't want to get into court. Now, here's the explanation. A gentleman here talking about fish. Actually, this graph here is taken from a publication in the 1980s from some people at Harwell who went along with big sheets, and they hung these sheets up on the coast, and they moved inland and put some more sheets up and so on. And then they measured the sheets to see how much plutonium was on the sheet, you see? Like a bed sheet, a big piece of cloth, yeah? They found that this is a logarithmic graph, see? So this goes 1, 10, 100, 10, 100, 1,000, okay? So these are the concentrations of plutonium on these sheets as you go inland so many kilometers. And you can see that all the plutonium is in the first 1 kilometer. And it's inhaled. The children inhale it, the parents inhale it, it's there. And in fact, if you live near the sea, which I do, and I guess some of you do as well, you know that sometimes when the wind blows, you get your car is covered with salt crystals, you know, and you have to clean the car, or the window is covered with the sort of dirty, dirty salt crystals. And this is where this stuff comes from. And this is a mud core taken from near Sellafield, and you can see, that, and then it's put in a core, you put a pipe into the mud, and then you freeze it, and then you cut it, and then you put a photographic plate there, and you can see these are the alpha emitters, the particles of alpha emitters, which are there. So that's the explanation for the curious, sharp decrease in, because you see, if it was just the fish, you're not going to get people only in 1 kilometer eating the fish, you know. Mm. That you get people along the whole coast eating the fish, and actually people quite far inland as well. And also we've done studies with fish eaters, which doesn't suggest that there's a problem with fish eaters. And actually, a lot of this stuff comes right inland. This is a mussel, this one. This is a cross-section of autoradiograph. I've got to finish now, have I? Okay. Well, all right, well, I can gallop through this, but this is radioactivity in the mussel from one of these particles. I think kind of covered it, really. Oh, yes, this one here, this one is... This is plutonium in sheep droppings by distance from the coast, right the way across the whole country. So you can see this stuff goes quite far. Now, what else is there? Supporting evidence, child leukemia. Well, we found child leukemia in Scotland as well, and around the nuclear site at Bradwell, we found increased breast cancer. This is in that picture I showed you earlier with the mud. This is the cancer rates. We actually asked, this was the IRA, I think, asked this. We're in Northern Ireland, the provisional IRA people went and knocked on doors for me. Mm. And they asked how many people had cancer in the various houses. Of course, everybody answered, you know, because you don't answer these people. So this has had a 95% response rate. This was the most amazing response rate of any study ever done, I think. I don't think they actually had pistols on them, but, you know. Anyway, so you can see it's all along the coast by the mudflats is the cancer. So that's the problem that you have here. The Hinkley Point, we also, this is Hinkley Point, discharging into the sea. This is a power station in Somerset. And you can see also big mudflats here, all along here. There's a huge cancer excess, childhood leukemia, adult cancers and so on, breast cancer mainly there. And so, yeah, okay, so the conclusions I've got here, which is that the increase in childhood leukemia and other cancer primarily caused by exposure to internal radionuclides, the model used to underpin the operation of the nuclear plants and their discharges are wrong by large amounts. And that's clear in Chernobyl studies. The current cancer epidemic in adults has the same principal cause, and coastal populations near fission product and uranium-contaminated sediment suffer excess risks, and you'll find that here as well. Okay?
Do you have this on your home page? And what?
Well, picture.
Yes,
if you want more information on this, there's a lot of it on the page on the home page of the Low Level Radiation Campaign.
We have it in our newspaper.
Okay. Which is here, LLRC.org.
Yeah.
And I've also a lot of my papers are on this one called Green Orbit.
It's a newspaper.
Yeah,
this newspaper here has two articles. One from the New Scientist that was supposed to be published, some more here. Yes. So get the magazines on the table so you can continue. Birgitta Müller from Helsingborg, Green Party campaigner.
ESS. I was thinking about who is taking the decisions, where is the level of decision making, and what are regulating these things. So I was looking first into the Lisbon Treaty, but I was looking a bit into the Lisbon Treaty and Euratom Treaty to get some ideas about these things. And I wanted to show first thing Sweden's what we pay to this Euratom budget. As you can see, it's about 5 billion in 2006.
Swedish crowns,
of course, but still, you can see it's the increase here. Mm-hmm.
10 million.
Yeah. You can ask why it's increasing like this. And we're still only in 2006 here. Yeah, one odd thing that we have noticed is that Euratom is officially superior to the European Union. And that's a new article in the Lisbon Treaty. Nobody knew this before. It's very odd, but it's clear. You can see it here for yourselves. And what I was thinking about was, should a small country like Sweden deal with big issues like this ESS project? You have to think about that for yourselves, but The Lisbon Treaty, this is Article 2. It says that the member states are entitled to the allocated rights of decision making only if the union does not. Oh. And this is shared decision making. Mm-hmm. And of course, the member states may again, only the language tells you what it's all about, they may again use their allocated right of decision making. It's so odd. You mean you don't believe it's true?
That's subsidiarity, they call that. Mm.
Yeah.
Subsidiarity, and they tell us it's decentralization. Yeah. It's only decentralization if they haven't already decided.
And this is shared thinking, in their opinion, not in mine. I was thinking. And this one, your atom treaty. I just wanted to show who founded, what countries founded this. I guess you know, but still. Then, the task of the Euratom Treaty is, of course, a priority of nuclear power. And we all know that, promoting nuclear research, facilitating investments. And that makes me ponder about what investments do they put in Sweden now in uranium mining? And what investments do they put in this ESS project? I think we have to find out. Article 3, it's this new one. I have to put it over again because it's so odd. I was so astonished to see it. I never thought it could be like this. It's so curious.
Can you read it?
It's fantastic. Yeah, well, it's that the European Union is really, what do you say, it's Euratom is superior to the European Union. Yeah, the tasks entrusted to the Euratom community, from the Euratom community, shall be carried out by the following institutions. And then they entrust the European Parliament, the Council, the Commission, a Court of Justice, a Court of Auditors, but a court. But this court, it's only living in the text. It doesn't exist. They use the ordinary EG court. But in the text, it's like this, from the start up till now, it's still there. I don't know why, because with every new treaty, they change this Euratom. And that shows as well that it's in the treaties. Not as I say, it doesn't belong to the treaties, but it does, because they change it in every treaty. They change the Euratom treaty.
No, well, it hasn't been treated. It continues as a protocol.
Yes, but the new Lisbon treaty. I know, but now so it's an annex.
The Euratom Treaty is one of the founding treaties of the European Community.
Yes,
it has been unchanged for almost 50 years.
Yes, but my aspect is why? How can they change? When they change those treaties, how can they change the Euratom treaty if it doesn't belong? If it doesn't,
it can be changed by an intergovernmental conference between all the member states. That's a problem because obviously some member states.
Then it's the same thing. Don't want to admit it.
Every member state can unilaterally withdraw from the Euratom treaty under the Vienna treaty on convention on treaties. That was recently proved by by a paper by the, from the University of Nuremberg, commissioned by the Green German Green Party's parliamentary group. It was also a topic at the conference that was organized in the Danish parliament a couple of years ago. So
but that's democratic bluff because they will never do. There is no country,
okay,
even if the majority...
They're working in Austria to do it.
Yeah,
well, this Article 6 is, of course, about encourage research programs, research and training programs. For every kind of research, of course. Even in the search of, or particularly in the fields of prospecting for minerals. Who knows who are paying the research in Sweden or Finland, actually. I don't.
We don't know.
And there is another and a very important aspect of this, and that is access to supplies. And that under that Article 52, you are to learn that right of options on ores, source materials, and fissile materials produced in the territories of member states. They are also exclusive right to conclude contracts. This is an agency that I never heard of before. But I started to scrutinize this text. There is an agency that is very powerful.
Won't this mean that uranium will be mined everywhere in Sweden where it's economically feasible in short time?
We have no say.
So no local veto will be respected if we accept this treaty.
Yeah, we have no.
Well, it should be mentioned that one of the main reasons for the ability for every member of EU to leave Evertum unilaterally. One of the reasons that was mentioned in this paper from the University of Nuremberg was that most parts of the Evertum Treaty did not enter into force as planned by the developers of the Evertum Treaty. And one of
we have to go on.
Yes, but
yeah, but especially the common ownership of fissile material in the EU has never entered into force, so this is actually just a paper tiger, according to...
paper tigers are not papers.
I'm sorry, we don't have time for discussion, we have to wrap up.
Lots of countries.
They're
signed by Sweden. It's signed by Sweden. So it's not a paper tiger to us. It's signed by Finland, so it's not a paper tiger to them.
No, this part of the Eurotube.
Niels, I'm sorry, but this is no discussion right now. She's having.
But it might any time it's needed. That's the way the EU functions.
Well, Article 56 is extremely important. It states that member states shall be responsible for ensuring that agency may operate freely in their territories. So there's not much we can do about it. I'm sorry. Authorization not granted when contract goes against interest of Euratom community. I mean, only by the language you can tell what it's all about. Article 3 again. The Euratom Treaty entitles the European Union to do
this. This was about prospecting, yeah?
Oh, yeah. Financial support to prospecting programs in the territories of the member states. We are talking about this agency again that nobody knows anything about. And, of course, the member states shall submit annually to the Commission a report on the development of prospecting and production. So we're all under that agency. And it's all over the same. It's recommendations are told the member countries by this agency. And well, they have the access to every source of materials that I want. Do we know who is the leading what do you say, decision makers in this area?
Is the Euratom a combination of governments and private companies?
No. It's a treaty between
just
countries,
treaty.
Like the Lisbon Treaty.
Yeah.
But so it's a protocol to
the conclusion, where do you see the connection with the European Spallation Source and Euratom? Are there any, in your opinion?
Sorry?
Is there any connection between Euratom and, in your opinion, and ESS in Lund?
Yes.
Where is the connection?
I think there are. The connection is like what decision making does Sweden have in ESS project, and is our role just to pay a lot for it? I think a small country like I have a feeling, and I hope I'm right, that we're just fooled to pay a lot for it. And we will never have it. I hope it's like that. Because they fooled our government it was last year, to sign this paper on to pay 30%.
Well, ESS is not mentioned in the seventh framework Euratom program.
No, but Euratom
was
founded in 1957. So
thank you very much. We have to go on our program.
I just wanted you to start reading these texts of Euratom and the new articles of the Lisbon Treaty. Just think about it.
Now I will introduce the chairman of our organization, the Swedish Anti-Nuclear Movement, Jörn Bunse, who is also a type of energy professor, has been teaching in issues of energy.
You and I have some good news for you. First, I'm just going to use 3 minutes, because what I'm going to say I have written in this paper, which you can obtain on the top of the higher. Secondly, the good news are that nuclear power has never been so expensive as today. According to Moody's price index now, $7,500 per kilowatt, corresponding to production cost of a kilowatt hour, about 1 Swedish crown or 10 EU cents. And if you compare that with the price of wind energy, which is very abundant, the price of new wind energy, according to US sources, is about 6 American cents per kilowatt hour. That means less than half of nuclear. So if we only could create a market economy, nuclear power would be dead today for economical reasons. Unfortunately, it's not so easy. So. But basically, we cannot afford nuclear energy for economical reasons. I will finish with another thing which I thought about when I heard previous presentations, that these complicated models are usually very too complicated. It can actually be mathematically proven strictly that if you have 5 parameters that you really cannot verify, so precisely. You can write an elephant on a diagram. It means you can prove anything you want. And that's the big problem with all these complicated computer models. They are so complicated, so you cannot believe it. And that can be mathematically proven strictly, that you can't believe in them if they have more than 5 parameters, or even 5 parameters, which they cannot certainly verify. Don't believe. Okay, so Linda.
Okay, my name is Linda Birkedal, and I'm the president of the Lund Society for Nature Conservation. And we are a local branch of a national NGO working with the nature and environment. And also the national organization has decided that we don't want the ESS in Sweden, and we don't want it at all, because it's a great hazard to people and to environment. For our part, we have a special committee working on the ESS, and at the moment we are looking specifically into the possibilities for us to handle this in a legal process, which we now see coming up. And about our view on the ESS, we say that, of course, new knowledge research is important, interesting, exciting, and all of that, but it is not worth the risks we see to the local society of Lund, but also a lot of people around the Öresund region. And our main concerns are, firstly, that the target they will use when they have a proton beam, the target they will use to get the neutron ray to look at the material they will study in this kind of big microscope, it will be a heavy metal that is very, very dangerous. We have reason to believe that it will actually be mercury, but also the other alternatives they show are very dangerous. We can say almost for sure that there will be either mercury or lead in the target. We also, from a local perspective, say that this land that they will use to build the facility can be of better use. It is a densely populated area, and they will risk the lives of many people, and we could also use this land for better purposes. We are also worried about radiation and that there will be nuclear waste, although and that is important, I think. It will not be, there is no reason, or it's not on the same scale as a nuclear power plant. It is less dangerous when it comes to radiation. And also the great energy demand worries us. And here we now can see that the ESS, they have had to notice that there is a local opinion against the ESS, and because of that they have made a significant effort to greenwash their activities. One way of doing that is claiming that this will be a CO2 neutral research facility. And that is during the period when they are using it. We say that if that should be true, they should also do it when they build it. And we also say that
in our community, in the municipality, there has been a decision from the politicians that we need to reduce our emissions of climate gases with 85% until 2050, and then we will need this alternative energy for other purposes. I will focus a bit also on these heavy metals. And it is and has for a long time been a very, very strict policy from the Swedish government that these are phase-out substances. We shouldn't use lead, we shouldn't use mercury anymore. And that is within Sweden. They have also worked very, very hard internationally to reach this in the European community and in the United Nations. Yes, this is about bioaccumulation. Both lead and mercury is bioaccumulating substances. And I won't describe it now because of the time shortage. But what about mercury? Why is it dangerous? What does it cause? It causes a lot of damage to humans and also to animals. It will, and the first point I think is maybe the most severe. Very, very low doses will cause damage to the nervous system, and it will also cause problems in reproduction. Children born that when their mothers have been exposed to mercury, their brains will be damaged severely, and it could also mean that people get sterile. How much mercury will be used? I was quoted here earlier today. It was almost correct. The highest number here, 60 tons, is if there are three goals in this research facility. What they say now is that there will be one, which is the lower number here, 20 tons, and that is a lot. 20 tons of mercury is a lot. When you look about on the hazard it puts upon people. I don't think that they will actually dare to come up with the idea of three targets because of the Seveso directive. So what we can see is either one, which is what they are saying now, but I believe that they are just wanting not to scare people. So that it is very, very possible that there will be two. And this is one of the things that has been very, very typical during these years that the ESS has been on the agenda, that the ESS Scandinavia is first giving one kind of information, and then when we ask them, why are you having these dangerous plans, they change their mind. They say, oh, no, 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 we're not going to do it like this. We're going to do it like this instead. A little less dangerous. And in some aspects, I think that it is actually the case that our criticism will make the facility less dangerous, but sometimes I think it's just a facade. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
A trick.
That's right.
and this is about lead, which is one thing that this is typically an example of this. We started criticizing the use of mercury very heavily, and then they said, oh, no problem, we will use lead instead. yes, as you can see, lead is also a heavy metal, very, very dangerous. And as I know that Bo has also a lot of interesting information, I think I will maybe finish with the latest idea that is a bit the other way around. It has the exact site of this facility has been all of the time very close to Lund with 100,000 inhabitants, but also in the center of the Öresund region. What they are doing in this case is not moving it further away from people, but closer to people. That is horrible. We thought it was too close already, and what we see here is the old suggestion about 1 kilometer from where people, a lot of people are living. But now it's moving closer to about here instead. So I think that is maybe some description of our work and the work of ESS Scandinavia. What we are doing now is finding out how we should handle the process in court if it hopefully gets there and the government doesn't just take it as their decision. One important part here now in the close future is that the municipality of Lund, the health and environment department, should force the ESS to have an environmental trial in court and to make a good environmental impact assessment, because as it's said now, this facility is new, which means it's not in the Swedish law and we don't know how to handle it. They say, okay, we will make this voluntarily, but if they make it voluntarily, they can do it when half of the work is already done, when they have built half of the ESS facility, and look into the details they find interesting. The difference is huge to the municipality of Lund forcing them to do it, because then they can say to the politicians of Lund, you need to do this before you start building, and also point out what aspects, what environmental aspects do you have to look into. And that is a huge difference, because this means you could actually say no. If you're halfway through building it, you have invested so much money, that answer no is not really something you could expect. So, okay, thanks for your attention.
I'd like to introduce Mina Wistrand, who is also from Lund and has done many different things. She formed or initiated an environmental green library in Lund.
everybody is very tired now. It's a long listening, but it's very exciting to have so many with us against the EPSS, which is really a monstrous project. I don't see how all the political parties locally and nationally, except the Green Party, they are all very positive to this dangerous, expensive and unnecessary project. So we have made an appeal and published it in this environment magazine, Milieu Magazine, and we have got quite a few names, not many enough. So we want to ask you if you would like to sign this appeal against the ESS. You can find it on www.nuvinfo.se/ESS protest. Or you can sign on this paper, back and front. I know that many of you have already signed, but we want all. That is one thing that really has worried me very much, and that is that it's so quiet about very important criticism, like two students at the Technical University in Lund, at the fire extinguishing line or whatever, they're going to be fire brigade engineers, and they have said that there is going to be mercury, that must not come into use because it must be forbidden by Chemicalia Inspektion, the chemical inspectorate. It should be replaced with something that is not dangerous. They are going to use hydrogen gas to cool it, and it's a very dangerous, easily inflammable gas, and it can make the whole thing explode. The ESS generates radiation, and after we have finally closed the Barsebäck reactor, we don't want another nuclear facility even closer to all the people in our city. So I think there is very important reasons to stop it. So please help us spread the message and make people wake up. Here is the appeal, if you would like to sign it. Thank you.
Ja, tiden är kort, så jag har också kortat ner mitt inlägg lite grann på en del av det hela. Vad sa du?
English, please.
Kort. I have shortened a little bit what I was going to say. I will come back where I finished before. we will just look a little bit into the details of the target and what is going on there in this ESS facility. Last time earlier today I told you about fission taking place inside this reactor. Of course, this is not the main process, but the ESS Scandinavia completely denies that there is fission taking place in this reactor. And the reason why is why they are so sensible to this little issue is that it could be classified as a nuclear facility if it is like this. And I will show you that it is the case. Here is a picture from what is some of the compounds formed during fission reactions inside the mercury target. You recognize iodine, some of them isotypes that are radioactive. And you, as you know, maybe this is what one thing you fear when there are atomic bombs or accidents in nuclear reactors, that iodine will escape and it is concentrated in the human glands. And of course there are some isotopes from mercury. Gold is also formed, interesting. But it shows anyway that in some fission is taking place inside the reactor. This is a picture from the American SNS. And here is when they open up and are going to change a piece of the target. This piece here is possible to empty from mercury and to remove. It becomes very strongly radioactive. The proton beam enters here, and the shell of here from thin iron will become more and more get some damages. Some it will lack strength after a while, and also inside. You have, when the proton beam comes, boiling mercury with bubbles that collapses, and you get these cavitation forces, like when you have a water pipe with gas inside, and it starts to vibrate very heavily. So to dampen out this, they must inject gaseous helium into the mercury. Anyway, to avoid to prevent this from breaking, they have to change it after 45 days of use. Then they have to actively cool down because of the radioactive processes that do not stop immediately when you close the electrical circuit, but it will continue and will create heat inside. So they have to cool it down for some days. Another risk is two hydrogen filled moderators with liquid hydrogen that comes into and to making the neutrons going a little bit slower, so they won't damage the pieces you are studying in this microscope. Here we can see the mercury circuit. Here is the piece that is have to be changed. Under is a dump where you let out the mercury when you change this piece. And the dump is about 5 tons of mercury. And the active mercury that is in the circuit is about 15 tons. So that is why there is a small confusion about how much mercury is really used in each target. 15 tons is circulating and 5 tons is in the dump. But 1 ton of mercury, more or less, maybe it doesn't matter. Here is the same picture you can see I showed to you earlier. And maybe it would be possible to read this text. I think it was not so easy, but they are talking about remaining mercury droplets inside the target models will have to evaporate, and so on. And as far as I can see, this cannot be considered as a closed target. It cannot be considered as a closed circuit when you are forced to open it up every 1.5 months to change important pieces, take this out. They are so radioactive, so we cannot touch them. They have to be in an intermediate storage before you can transport it away. Here is a whole procedure how to change the target piece. Now now since the active removal of decay heat for the first 12 hours. So it's not enough to just cut off the electricity and everything is okay. An accident could happen if the electricity goes away permanently. All these pictures I had here in the last part, they were taken from their own papers and investigation that is made centrally in Europe by the former ESS Council. And if you want to see the links to this, you can look at the homepage of Lunds Naturskyddsförening. Elena. Thank you very much.
I just have a short message from the organizers of all the activities in Malmö. They say it's quite important that we go and get a participant passport like this. Each one should have them. With a name and so on.
For one day.
Is it here?
They said this morning that it was supposed to be here, but asked downstairs in the reception because there were some problems this morning. And we are not supposed to let anyone in if they haven't got these ones, but as there were so many problems, we couldn't ask you for the passports.
You could not ask for them.
We have a visitor from Turkey. We don't have much time, but he would like to say a few words. Maybe you should say your name too.
Thank you very much. My name is Tanay Sıtkuya. I'm a professor in Marmara University. I'm a nuclear master's, PhD with coal, but now I'm an associate professor of renewable energy in Turkey. So when I was graduated in 1980, the cancellation of the tenders in USA has started, as you all know, due to the cost, as you have mentioned. The citizens, they don't want around them such a facility which they need to be protected from. The third one is the waste. The fourth is the monitoring by the Nuclear Regulatory Commission is too expensive. So these are the main reasons. After 1978, no tenders, and 100 of them also canceled, which were ordered in 1973. Germany, you know, is taking everything down. And UK is trying to calculate how they will decommission this £91 billion is required for 19 reactors. This means for each decommissioning one, we need $8 billion. So I'm here representing my trade union, education trade union, and public trade unions confederation in Turkey also. So after looking at the discussions, I did want to share with you my views. This Aarhus Convention on environmental matters, we have access to information, public decision-making, participation of citizens in decision-making process, and access to justice. So we need to have our countries be a signatory on this. This is one thing, but we cannot wait for this. So what we did in Turkey, I'm coordinating this activity. Farmers, trade unions, consumer associations, medical doctors, and environmental NGO platforms, about 100 NGO. We are just trying to inform citizens, every single citizen, about energy efficiency and renewable energy. It works, and it's not an illusion. And the problem is fossil fuels and nuclear, and the solution is renewable energy and energy efficiency. They try to tell us, yes, we'll do all of them. Renewable energy, this is not possible. You cannot ask your child to smoke or not to smoke at the same time. So this is the one thing. The other thing I want to share with you, when you look from my country's point of view, the picture is a little bit different. But over here, as I see in Lund, the destination is becoming Lund over here. In Europe. But as we all know, nuclear power plants are not really power plants. They don't produce electricity. The harvest factor is 0.35. This means one nuclear power plant machine, starting from the fuel preparation up to the point of the commissioning, consumes 3 times more energy than it is producing. So this is a good enough justification for us not to take nuclear power plant machine as an energy production thing. Oh, it produces plutonium, this is okay, but for France, for example, we cannot say that they are producing their electricity 75% from nuclear. They are trying to be power for war. No, I'm just finishing. As a war equipment, 75%, yes. But the electricity comes out, so they cannot throw it away. They just sell it cheap to whoever receives. So we are ready in Turkey with all this structure with you to cooperate. I will give my information. I'm very happy that I have selected this seminar in this one. Thank you very much to all of you. I would like to say yes, I will just give my information to anybody. Thank you very much.